Hi everybody, I'm Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium. Today, we're gonna talk about your schematics and your PCB layout. Specifically, what keeps them all synchronized. If you're using the right ECAD software, your software will enforce the synchronization automatically. You don't really need to do much except click a couple of options in your menu. However, if you're using other packages, you'll have to actually use a specific design document to enforce that synchronization, and you'll have to import that document manually and force your PCB layout to update to reflect your schematics. That specific design document is called a schematic netlist. So, what is a schematic netlist? Within your schematics, you have all of your components, right? Your components contain a lot of CAD data that gets used inside the PCB layout. Now, the schematic netlist has to reflect the connections between all of your components in your schematics, and then match that in the PCB layout. So, your components in your schematics contain a lot of different data. First, there's obviously the schematic symbol, and you can see all of the pins on the schematic symbol and the pin numbers. If you go into the PCB layout, you then see a component outline that represents the physical dimensions and physical placement of the pads, and you'll also see the connections between different pads on different components. So, what is it that makes all of this stuff match up between these different documents? That's where your schematic netlist comes in. Your schematic netlist is like a big list of your nets in your schematics and in your PCB layout. They did give it the right name. And it's really that bridge that gets built between the schematic and your PCB layout. Different ECAD programs have different data formats that they enforce in your schematic netlist. But that's okay. All schematic netlists are encoded in ASCII format, so they're all human readable. You could open them up in a text editor and start reading off all the different lines and really decode that data format if you wanted to. You could even edit your own schematic netlist, if you can get a hold of it, using your text editor and modify the connectivity that's defined in your schematics. Pretty cool, huh? Now, your PCB design software does all of this modification for you automatically, so you don't have to actually get into the schematic netlist and start typing stuff in. So when you're looking at your schematics inside your PCB design software, what they show you is just graphical. It's a graphical reflection of the data that's stored in your schematic netlist. The PCB layout basically does the same thing. It just defines different regions on the board that are confined to pads, copper, vias, traces, whatever it may be. That's also defined graphically in your PCB design document. But the actual electrical rule, the electrical connection between those different elements, that's all defined in your schematic netlist. And so your schematic netlist gets used to define, let's say, spice simulations. Whenever you need to define specific measurements in a spice simulation, that's taken from your schematic netlist. Whenever you need to, let's say, check for electrical rule satisfaction. So, did we make a short circuit somewhere? Did we leave an open circuit somewhere? That's also defined by looking at your schematic netlist. What does an entry in a schematic netlist actually look like? Well, like I said earlier, it really depends on the ECAD program. However, there is kind of a general structure that you can build in your netlist. And the exact data format will depend on the ECAD application you're using. Once you understand the information you're actually looking at, you could conceivably decode your own schematic netlist and start typing up your own. That would then get reflected in your schematics that you've drawn in your PCB design software. So, the first piece of information is a net name. And every net in your schematics and your PCB has a name. And it could be auto-generated. You could give it your own name. Usually you give it a name based on the protocol, a pin number, or the signal name within that protocol. So if you're using like I2C or SPI, those nets will have specific names. And it's best practices to do that just so you can keep track of everything. The next piece of information is the reference designator where you start the net and a pin number. So this reference designator is for a specific component in your schematic. The pin number is the actual pin on the component where the net begins. Now the net has to go somewhere, so it goes to reference designator number two. And on reference designator number two, there's some other pin number. And so this defines some net name and the electrical connection between reference designator number one, this pin, and reference designator number two, this pin. So this could be, for example, this could be a resistor, and this could be the input pin on a capacitor. And my net name, let's just say as an example, it's, we'll call it net RC. So if I were to look in my ECAD software and look at my my circuit diagram and my schematics, I'd first have a resistor, and we're gonna call this pin one, and this may connect to a capacitor, and we'll just call this pin two on the capacitor. That means this side is pin one. So this net, we've already said, is gonna be named net RC, and this entry here for RD1 is just my reference designator. And here, this would be RD2 for my capacitor. And so if I were to write this connection up in a net list, it's pretty simple. It would just be net RC and then space RD1-1, RD2-2. And your net list is gonna be full of these rows of different data. And they're all gonna have different net names. They're all gonna have all these different connections. And your PCB design software is gonna use this to check that the connections made in your schematic actually match the connections that you make in your PCB layout. So anytime you make a change in your schematic, you need to then update that in your PCB layout. And your software can do this for you. So some software will actually force you to take this file full of all these different nets and manually import it into your project and then manually apply some synchronization. Other software will do this for you automatically. So all you do is you go up into an option on the menu bar, select a couple of settings and click update, and it will automatically force that synchronization and the nets will update in your PCB layout. You then go through your PCB layout and make all the required modifications. You're good to go. So one of the goals in creating your schematics is to make sure that they're readable and legible. You need to make sure that other engineers can pick up your schematics and basically decode everything that you've done. All of that work should be able to be interpreted by another designer. Now, there's no specific industry rules for how to wire up your schematics. However, there are some best practices that you can implement in your design software to make sure that someone else can read your schematics easily. So let's take a look at what not to do, and then I'll show you the best practices to using net names and ports. All of that is going to get reflected in your schematic netlist and then synchronized back to your PCB layout. Inside this schematic, we have many crossed wires, open connections on a connector J2, unclear inputs and outputs, missing reference designators, missing notes, and wires where net names or ports would be preferable. And it's easy to get confused reading this kind of schematic. And trying to integrate it with more sheets would be challenging without the right CAD tools. Instead, you should use multiple sheets with objects like ports and net names to define connectivity within and between schematics. Net names and ports give you a simple way to define net connectivity in your schematic sheets. Using ports and net names allows you to define inputs and outputs clearly, and it helps you declutter your schematics so that they're much easier to read. As you build up your schematics and add new components, it's easy to add new ports and set net names to define net associations in multiple schematic sheets. Best practices state to use net names for connections inside a schematic sheet and use ports for connections between multiple sheets. Here, J21 defines the connection back to connector J2, pin 1, over here in my other schematic sheet. As you keep adding components, you'll need to route power to multiple locations in a schematic sheet. To cut down on excessive placement of wires in a schematic, use a power port to define objects and connections back to your power bus or power plane on the physical PCB. Ports are the standard way to define power connections without placing wires all over the schematic and creating too much clutter. These will be defined inside your schematic netlist, and they'll enforce that synchronization back to your PCB layout. The same ideas are helpful when defining connections to large integrated circuits, connectors, and multi-symbol components. If you're using large integrated circuits or pin header connectors, there are some best practices you should follow to make sure your schematics are readable. Take a look at the schematic symbols for connectors J1 and J2. Instead of manually wiring up every single pin connection to the components, these ports define connections to other elements in your schematic sheets. It's usually a good idea to try and place integrated circuits and large connectors near the schematic center. That way, it's easier to place inputs and outputs in the design. However, this is not required as long as the schematic is still readable. The important point here is to make use of net names and ports to define schematic connections, as it helps you keep things clear and easy to read in your schematics. Take a look at the schematic symbol for this STM32 microcontroller. This microcontroller has a lot of pins on it. Here you can see I can easily call out the different connections in my SPI bus on pins B14, B13, and A12. By nicely naming these ports the same name as the signal for this SPI bus, another engineer can easily come in and pick out which portion of the bus I'm talking about and can easily follow these connections around the schematic. Here we're using net names to define connections inside the sheet, and we're using ports to define connections to other components in different sheets. When you need to create clear schematics, you need the best ECAD software with a complete set of schematic capture and PCB layout tools. That's why you should use CircuitMaker, the free PCB design software platform from Altium. All right, everyone, I'd like to thank you for watching this video and taking some time to learn about schematic netlists and how they help enforce connectivity in your schematics and your PCB layout. One of the great things about CircuitMaker is it automatically enforces all of that connectivity. You don't have to worry about exporting a netlist, re-importing it later, and then going through some rigmarole with your software to make sure that you've enforced that connectivity and synchronization. CircuitMaker does it all for you. Tap that like button, hack that YouTube algorithm for us, leave your comments below. In the description, we have a link to CircuitMaker where you can go download it for free and learn more. Thanks, everybody.